Rhonda Lee Master, and I'm part of the women's ministry team. And I agreed to do announcements because Pastor Tony told me I could talk about shoeboxes. Sign up to be a part of Heaven's Gate and Hell's Flames at the Welcome Center and at all Joy on the Go locations. We are looking for teachers for the Joy Zone on Sunday morning and for the months of September on Wednesday nights. See Clark Goble or Carla DePue if interested. There will be No Run for God on August the 18th. And some other upcoming dates. From August the 18th to the 20th will be Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames production at 7 p.m. On August the 24th is a youth cookout. See Brian and Daphne for more information. On August the 24th, the women's group will be going to the movies to see The Forge. See Cindy Moody for details. On September 7th is the women's breakfast at Golden Corral at 9 a.m. Now I want to talk to you about Operation Christmas Child Shoeboxes. When you pack a shoebox, you are sending more than just a shoebox filled with gifts. Each shoebox is actually a gospel opportunity because every child receives gospel literature in their own language. They have the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and enter into a discipleship program. There have been many stories from the field of not only children accepting Christ, but entire families and even villages coming to the Lord. And churches have been planted all over the world because of a simple shoebox gift. Please see our Operation Christmas Child display. Shoeboxes will be available soon, and please pray about how many gospel opportunities you want to send. Our goal for this year is 300 shoeboxes. And mark your calendar for our packing party on Sunday, October the 20th at 5:30 p.m. It's going to be a fun evening for all. Now let's get ready to worship.
Good morning. Welcome to Real Joy on Your Feet. We're going to worship Him today. Amen. Old time song.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world Thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe display. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from the lofty and feel the gentle,
come on, church.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
God, how great.
time of fellowship. We're glad you're here today. Turn around, wave at somebody, shake hands, tell them you love them. We serve a great God. Welcome in the house. Welcome Facebook Live. Worship Jesus with us. Sing, church.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Serve a great God. How great thou art. Amen. Yes, praise Him, church. Praise Him, church. We're glad you're here today. We've come to worship Jesus. If you don't know Him, we're going to tell you about Him. He'll make a way where there ain't no way. Because He rose up from an empty grave, and there ain't no sinner that He can't save. That's my Jesus. That's my Jesus. Come on, Dad.
Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change.
you've been changed by the blood of Jesus. How about a wave offering right now? I'm not afraid of the gospel of Christ, and I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto all who believe. Sing the chorus, Daphne. Sing it, come on, church.
You're not alone, stop holding on.
I'm on the throne, stop holding on, just be Him. On the cross, you know I always have and I always will. And not a tear is wasted. In time you'll understand. I'm painting beauty with the ashes. My life is in your hands. So when you're on your knees, the answer seems so far away. You're not alone, stop holding on. Not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on, and just be Him.
He's got you. job, good job. You can be seated. The Spirit of the Lord is in this place. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we'll prepare for our morning offering. Continue to pray for everything that's going on within the church. Pray for the remainder of this service. All focused on Jesus. You've probably noticed the platform looks different. Getting ready for this evening for heaven's gates and hell's flames. Listen, it is real. Jesus is real. This is not some worked up, emotional experience. He is real. He is real when we're excited. He is real when we're not. Our worship is not about how we feel. Our worship is not about what's going on in our life. Our worship is about Him. To God be the glory in all things. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Your Spirit is here today. And Lord, as you move in and out of the aisles and you speak to everyone in this building, let us sense your Holy Spirit. Lord, we've worshiped you in song. We've worshiped you with our hands and with our feet. We've worshiped you with our voices. We've worshiped you with the instruments. And now, Lord, we're going to worship you with our finances. You have blessed our homes. You have blessed our families. You have blessed our children. You have blessed our children's children. And we thank you. So as we give back, thank you for your blessings, Jesus. Take this offering, bless it, use it, and multiply it for the upbuilding of your kingdom. We love you. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Hi, good morning. My name is Tony Lambert. I'm the pastor here at Real Joy Community Fellowship. We are so thankful that you are joining us today, and hopefully you are enjoying your time of worship with us. We have pulled away from our live stream for a moment because we are taking up our offering. Our offering is an act of worship between that individual and God. In fact, if you read in Malachi chapter 3, it says that we should bring our whole tithe into the storehouse. And then in the one place in the Bible that God says to test him in this area is that we are to bring our tithe into the storehouse, and then he'll open up the heavens floodgates and pour out blessings on those individuals, those people who trust him with their money and with their tithes and their offering. And so we consider Real Joy as our storehouse where they're being fed spiritually. And so those individuals in that room need that quiet time, that time where they're not being on a live stream, and they can give that their tithe back to God. Now, maybe you're at home today and you can join us, and this is considered your storehouse, and you are being fed spiritually here as well. You're worshiping with us and you're learning from God's word. And so maybe you want to give as well. So we have several ways that you can give. One is that you can mail in a tithe or an offering to P.O. Box 1973, Chillicothe, Ohio 45601. Another way that you can do that is you can go online to our website at www.real-joy.org and click on the Give tab and walk through that. Or, and the last way that you can do that, you can text to give at 84321. That's text to give at 84321. We're going to return back to our live stream here in a moment, but I just want to say thank you so much for joining us today and worshiping our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, ushers. Thank you, congregation. Thank you, praise team. Great job, as always. Good job, good job, good job. I appreciate our praise team so much. Don't you guys appreciate our praise team? So I've had some people, you know, ask about some of our praise team. It's like, man, where did you go to get all those great musicians? Did you go to Columbus? Are they coming in from everywhere just on Sundays or whatever? And it's like, they're all Real Joy people. Real, Real Joy people. We appreciate them a whole bunch. As Pastor Tony's coming, the children can be dismissed to the Joy Zone. We always have exciting stuff in the Joy Zone. We love our kids and we love those that serve and teaching our kids about Jesus. Awesome, awesome, awesome. If you love Pastor Tony, say amen. Amen. Yes, absolutely. Appreciate you, brother.
Appreciate you. You can't go that way. You got to go.
I can, but I would have to hurdle.
Yeah.
I'm going to go this way.
Yeah, go that way. All right. So good to see everybody this morning. And it's good to be here and preaching God's word and sharing. And it's just exciting seeing what God's doing. It's been an exciting couple of weeks. And we're going to get rolling. I want to pray. You know, I thought about this, for those of you who are visiting, you know, most time I'm a little bit ADHD, but I also like to have a lot of fun and carry on. And I thought when Mark would introduce me, you know, come on, Pastor Tony, I was going to walk out of heaven to come down, and I wanted you all to go, oh. You know, but no, I'm joking about the oh, because more than likely I'm saved. But here's the thing I thought. You know, I was getting ready this morning and I thought about that and I said, you know what, I'm going to step out of heaven. It's going to just be awesome, you know. Then I started thinking, you know, the one thing that we won't be able to do in heaven is tell people about Jesus because he's already there and everybody there is saved. And so we need to get real and get busy. Because I think we're in the last days. I just see things unfolding, and so that is why we do this. And so we want to tell as many people as possible about Jesus. So if you have someone that is lost, someone that's not where they should be with in their spiritual walk, get them here Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night. I promise you, you. If they get tired of hearing you preach to them, or you're afraid to say, Dwayne, afraid to say how I'm gonna mess up. Hey, you get here, they're gonna hear God's word acted out on stage, and we're saying, hey, we're asking for a $3 donation, but I'm telling you this: if money's an issue, it's not an issue. I want you here no matter what. And I'll tell you this, I'll do this to you. If you, as a church member of Real Joy, will bring someone lost, that person and you will get in free. Does that make sense? I want you here. I want them here. We just say that because here's the thing. I've done some other types of ministries like this. And they said, you know, if you don't charge something, people think it's fake. And this is a story behind that. A guy put his refrigerator out there on the edge of the curb and said, free. And it was a working refrigerator. He just got a new one. He thought, I just blessed someone else and I put a free sign on it. Would you know that sat there for 2 days? He went out there and put on their $5. Someone stopped and bought it. Because they saw value in what he had. If it was free, it was junk. And I'm telling you this, Jesus is not junk. All right. And so that's why I say $3 donation. That's the whole point behind that. And so the gospel is free. And that's why I say, hey, it's for whoever wants to come, right? So let's open up in prayer. We'll jump into God's word. Let's do that. Father God, I come to you right now. Just thanks so much for your word and how it speaks to us. And God, as we open your word, we thank so much for the musicians and the singers and just the worship, just that time to be able to come to your throne and praise you. Father, we know that in Isaiah, we're saying, worthy, worthy. And then in Revelation, the seraphim are still saying the same words, praising your name. And so, God, we know it's going to be a time of praise and worship when we're in your midst. Father, I just love to hear the people sing and have it bouncing off the walls and resonate onto my ears. I can't imagine what it's like for you. But God, right now, as we open your word, it's not by accident we're here. We have a divine appointment for you, to speak to us. You know where we are emotionally. You know where we are spiritually. And you know exactly where we are physically, here in this building or at home listening. So God, I'm asking you to speak to each and every one of us. And I'm praying that the Spirit moves in this room. Father, I'm praying that as people, the hearers, we're not just hearers, but we're doers, and that we take your word and we receive it and pull it into us and apply it to our lives as we grow in you. God, right now, it's all about you. We love you and we thank you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, I'm so thankful that you as a church saw the forbearance to go ahead and put these screens up on the sides, because it had been pretty difficult since it's covered up back here. So this worked out pretty good. We do this every Sunday. If you're visiting, we hold our Bibles, our swords up in the air, and we say these words: man shall not live by bread alone, but by every... Now, I do this every once in a while, but I'm going to ask you right now, do you believe that you need to live off of God's word? Yes, cover to cover. Yes, the things that you like and the things you don't like. Because God spoke it for a reason and to apply to us. And so you can go ahead and take your Bibles, turn to 1 John. We've been walking through the book of 1 John each week. And last week we talked about following the commandments, remember? Being obedient to the commandments. And he said, hey, if you're in the light, if you're walking in the light of Jesus Christ, then you should be doing the things he tells you to do. Now, he takes that word commandment today, and we're going to go a little bit further. He expands on it for us, the reader, and for those who are getting this letter, and it says, hey, look, this right here, I'm going to pinpoint this one commandment that we should be following. So we're going to jump into God's word, 1 John chapter 2. We're going to begin reading in verse 7 through 9. If you've got your outline to follow along with us, I hope you have that. And I'll also refer to some others, so that you can get along, write scripture down on the side. Remember, 1 John towards the back. If you go backwards, you go Revelation, okay? Then you go Jude, 3 John, 1 John, 2 John, 1 John, all right? So 1 John chapter 2, verses 7 through 9, the Bible reads this way. Beloved, he's talking to the Christians. Beloved, I'm not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard. On the other hand, I'm writing a new commandment to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. Until now. Now, so John's taking this and he's saying, look, I'm not writing you something new. You've already heard this before. In fact, if you go to Deuteronomy, don't turn there right now for the sake of time, but Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, we are told that we are supposed to love the Lord the God with all our heart and all our mind and all our soul, right? He says, love the Lord God. Love him, love him, love him. But when Jesus is on here, he expands that a little bit, and he takes it, and Jesus had a way of making it apply to you. He makes it apply to you. He makes it apply to you. He makes it personal, so it's not talking about someone else. He's talking about you. So put something in 1 John. We're going to go to Matthew chapter 5. Look what it says here. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 through 48. Matthew 5, 43 through 48. Jesus is talking here and just sharing things. You know, he makes a way of just making it go right to you. Pinpoint. And look what he says. You have heard that you should love your neighbor and hate your enemy. See, that was added. We like to twist words of God. And he says, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he calls us his son to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Verse 46, for if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Pause just for a second. Okay, so I'm going to add some notes in there. It's not going to cost you anything extra. This is free. Okay, so here's the deal. What he says is this. He says, hey, listen, Almighty God, remember we saw in James chapter 4, verse 17, all good things come from him. Every good thing. Now, we just read Jesus saying, hey, look, good things come to those who know him and those who don't. The sun's going to shine on those who are righteous and unrighteous. And then he goes on and says this, look, do not even the tax collectors do that? How would you like to be classified, and you're not even associated with sinners? Because when they would talk and they would talk about different people, they'd go, we're talking about these people, the sinners and tax collectors. They were in their own group. They were the worst of the worst. The Jews really hated them. Because they were extorting their own people. And so they were in their own group. And he said, don't even the people who you think are the worst do the exact same thing? Don't they do the same thing? But look in verse 47. If you greet only your brothers, more are you doing than others. Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Therefore, you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. That's what we should be doing as Christians. We should be striving to be perfect, holy in his sight. We know we're going to mess up from time to time, but I'm telling you what, I should be better today than I was yesterday. I should be better today than I was a year ago. Now, I might stumble, but then I come back and say, God, please forgive me for what I've sinned. 1 John 1:9, and we just keep rolling, right? Keep rolling, rolling, rolling. Okay, turn over to Matthew 22, Matthew chapter 22. Look what it says here, Matthew 22. Verses 34-40. Matthew chapter 22, we're going to start in 34. Look what it says here. But when the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered themselves together. One of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. Then the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depends the whole law and the prophets. So what were they? Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, who's my neighbor? Do you mean the people living? That sweet old lady, it's easy next door to love her. I'm telling you what, she bakes brownies, brings them out. She takes, I'm telling you, she gets the mail for us. She's just the sweetest thing. You know what, that word, when you can look at that, that means those who are close and those who are distant. So anyone that I run into, you're my neighbor. You're my neighbor. Our neighbor. Neighbor. We're all that way. So the first one on your outline right there. Jesus taught if you truly love God, then you would also love your neighbor as yourself. You know, I always tell people as a pastor, Billy Graham said the closer he got to God, the more he realized he was a sinner. Because the holiness of God, and we're striving to be holy, starts pinpointing the things that we need to take out. And so, you know, whenever I start thinking about things and I read, I'm supposed to love the neighbor as myself and I'm supposed to love God in a special way, I have to be honest with you at times. I don't even love myself the way I should love God. And so I kind of struggle with loving myself. Now, I love you guys as much as I possibly can. And I hug on you as much as I hate to hug. You know, I don't like hugging. You know, I'm kind of one of those, hey, you know, right here, this is my space. Please don't invade it, okay? You know, but I'll hug on you and I love on you. But when I look at myself, there's no way I can love myself like God loves me. And so I have a problem doing that, but I want to get to that point. I always seem to look at my imperfections. And when God says, hey, I'm going to impute my son's righteousness on you, you know, my righteousness right with God. And I see all that. So let's go on. John's writing these words, and he heard from Jesus that he replied. And John wrote saying, our brother, we should love our brother. And so Jesus says, all these commandments are built on these two. They are the greatest. And if you do these two, then the rest of what the Bible tells us to do and not do should be good to do. It should be easy to do those things. Because if we do those two, love, you know, hey, the Beatles, love is all you need. Okay. Hey, we love. Let me show you what I mean. Let me show you what I mean right here. I'm just going to work off 10 commandments, and I'm going to go through all of them. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods before him. You know what? If you do number one, he said the greatest commandment is to love the Lord God with all your heart and mind and soul, then you should love him. You should love him. That's the first one. You're doing pretty good. How about this one? Take the Lord's name in vain. If you love God, you wouldn't do that. You wouldn't talk about, well, some of you might talk about your wives that way, but I never would. I'm in my mind, I might have thought it, but I can say that she's not here right now. And so, you know, hey, listen to me. I would never, never disrespect my wife by calling her something that shouldn't be called. I'm supposed to treat her like the Bible says, to put her up on a pedestal because of love. Give unconditionally for her. That's what I should be doing. Okay? And so if I do, that's just two. Let's go on. Keep the Sabbath. How can you tell me you love God and you don't come and worship him? Well, I have my worship time at home and with Sister Sheets there. And, you know, you stayed in bed is what you done. I'm just going to tell you this. Listen, God's word in Hebrews says, forsake not the gathering of the saints until the end of time, encouraging one another until that day comes. You know what? When I walk in here, I walked out of here fired up. I'm pumped up because you guys are encouraging me. And that's what it takes. So I love God and I love you. So if I love neighbors, I'll be. How about this one? Honor your father and mother. Teens, I'm talking to you. Right? Honor your father and mother. I was big, bad Tony whenever I was behind the door. You know, you better not come back in here and say that to me. What'd you say? I didn't say nothing. You see what I'm saying? Honor your father and mother. You know, there's not a timetable on that. It's the rest of your life. Honor your father and mother. So if I love him, if I love God, then I can love my neighbors myself. Then how about this? Tell a lie. Well, it's just a little white lie. Well, it's a lie. Ain't nothing little about it. Lie's a lie. So you see, so if I love someone, I want to tell them the truth. It'll show how we treat our brothers and sisters and our neighbors that we have the light living in us. Jesus gives the story of the Good Samaritan. You remember the Good Samaritan? Everybody was too good to take care of the guy that had been laying in the road and he was in trouble. You know, and I'm just going to go to the other side of the road and he won't even know I went by him. And so and then the Samaritan, when Samaritan was with people, they just didn't want Jews didn't want anything to do with them. In fact, they wouldn't even let them worship in their temple. You're not coming in there. So the good Samaritan saw him as his brother and took him to the inn and paid him, said, you take care of him, get him healed up, and it's on me. Now, isn't that loving your brother as yourself? He didn't even know him. Stranger. And so they will know you by the way you treat your neighbor, your brothers and sisters. It'll show. Now, this is completely different than the world. If you don't believe me, get on Facebook for 2 minutes and you will understand. You post something on there and people are brave from home. They're brave from their phone and they'll come attacking. That's not what we're supposed to do. It's not what we're supposed to do. And if we go back to John and Matthew 22:40, loving God and loving your neighbors as yourself, the whole law depends on those two things. Everything. The reason I can say that Christians, that we can love like Jesus, the reason I can say that we can love like you call yourself a Christian, Christ-like. That's what, if you're a Christian, if you're Christ-like, striving to be perfect, if you are saying, I'm a Christian, Pastor, I'm worshiping the Lord, I'm here today. If you say you're a Christian, I can tell you this, and you can love just like he does. You can love just like Jesus did. You know why? Because he's living inside of you. And if he's living inside of you, then you're in the light, then you can do the exact same thing. You can love just like Jesus. You can love just like Jesus. Go back to 1 John 2:8. And I'm not saying, go back to 1 John 2:8. Look what it says here. I want just to read this just for a second. On the other hand, I am writing a new commandment to you, which is true in him. So if you write in your Bible, or if you got your phone, highlight it on your Bible app, highlight that, this part right here, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. So let me do some paraphrasing here, all right? I'm not going to add anything. I'm just going to do a paraphrase. Maybe you have an Amplified Bible at home. I'm just going to do the same thing. Here we go, all right? John says, hey, on the other hand, we talked about loving God. I'm going to take it when Jesus, and we're going to expand on that. And he says that if you are a Christian, you're no longer in the darkness. The darkness is fading away, which means that you are growing as a Christian, and the light is starting to shine out of you. And so I'm striving to be perfect. I'm striving to be holy. I'm striving to be more like Christ. And so whenever I am striving to be more like Christ, then it says it's in him, it's in Jesus that he did that and set the example for us. Then when he can do it, then so can you. Don't let the world tell you you can't. That's a lie from Satan. You can love everybody. You mean that LGBT, ABCD, AQT? Yes. You can love them. Okay? You mean that? Yes. You don't know what they did to me, Pastor. I don't care. Okay? We are to love. We are to love. I'll talk about that a little bit here in a moment. But go to Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. You got to build your case. You know what I'm saying? You got to build your case. I got to take you there. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Now, we're going to read the word hope here in a second, and I want you to understand what hope means. Hope, a biblical hope, is this. Biblical hope is a confident expectation that God's going to do exactly what he said he was going to do when he said he was going to do it. That makes sense. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. When he says he's going to do it at that exact same time, right? Look what it says, verse 5. And hope, biblical hope, does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. The moment that you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you, my brother and sister, have the Holy Spirit living in you. And so listen, there's no way you could tell me you can't love like Jesus did, because God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's living in you. Yeah. And so therefore you can love. Yeah. You can love him. Well, I'm not saying there's not a time for righteous anger. That's a totally different sermon, but we'll touch on it just for a second, because I know some of you have been hurt, and I want to talk to you just for a second, okay? I want to say some things, okay? I want to give you some examples, but there could be a time in your life where you need to have righteous anger. Paul tells us that we should mark those individuals who mistreat us, okay? I know who you are. I know the true you. And so, therefore, I know right here, but I still love you. I still love you. But I got that righteousness. Jesus, if you read Jesus, when they were in the temple robbing the priests, oh, you can't bring that lamb in here. You need to buy a new one. I got a new one out here. Or my temple weights are not exactly right, so I'm going to get rich off you guys. And so what Jesus says, I'll show you. And he takes it, and it says that Jesus went in there and he wove a whip. Drove him out of the temple. Righteous anger, right? Hey, you've made my place, it should be a house of prayer, not a place of den of thieves. And so that's what he said. But do you know what? That very same guy who had a righteous anger, Jesus, who's living God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we have the Holy Spirit living in us, and he's telling us what we should be doing and what we shouldn't be doing. That very same one, as he's being nailed to the cross, said what? Father, forgive them. That's love. That's love. If he can do it, so can I. So can I. We have so many Christians that struggle to show love to the world. Sometimes when we, you ever know that person's a hothead? Okay. Boy, I could lose my temper so fast you wouldn't believe it. But you know what? I want to tell you something. The world, listen, Christian, the world knows what you hate. Isn't it about time we show them what we love? Hey, you know what? I can love you because Jesus loves you. I don't care what party you're voting for. I love you because Jesus loves you. And I don't want you to spend eternity in hell. No way do I want that. Now, John takes that word brother, and we're going to apply that the way he meant it. He wrote these verses, and so John's saying, we cannot say we love God and hate a fellow Christian. Christians, you should be lifting each other up. Hey, I'm telling you, I'm so excited about you. You're going to make it through this. I'm praying for you, sister. You got this. We're going to get through this together. Put your arm around. I'm praying for you. Let's pray right now. Let's pray right now. We're going to pray for you. Let's do it. You see what I'm saying? We should be cheer. Hey, I'm proud. I've watched you since you come to Christ. There's been a change in you, Taryn. There's been a change in you. I've seen the difference in you. There's something different about you. What is it? It's God. And we cheer them on. Keep it up, sister. Keep it up. I love it. You see that? A lot of times we like to do this. Can you believe that person put that post? They're so holy. I tell you what, I go around John. He's always quoting scripture. I just wish he'd talk about the ballgame once in a while. Is that all he thinks about? Jesus? Hey, you know what? We should be encouraging each other. And the next one on your outline is this. Christians, you need to be a Barnabas. Barnabas. Barnabas actually means son of encouragement. You need to be encouraging one another. Encourage one. Hey, it's so glad to. I can't tell you the number of times I told someone today, I'm so glad to see you. I'm so glad to see you today. Shake their hand. You know, it's COVID. Everybody got scared to death of this COVID thing. We're not shaking hands. I shake hands. And so I shake hands. Hey, you know what? We'll just come. How you doing? Good seeing you today. Guess what? COVID now is just a big cold. Now, it's a rough cold at times for some people if you've got specific issues in your life. But I'm telling you, it's just. But so. And we talked about this, didn't we? We said, don't threaten me with a good time. If I catch COVID, so what? Absent from the body, present with the Lord. This is nothing compared to what it's really going to be like. All right? So, hey, yeah, don't, oh, yeah, bring it, brother. Now, I'd hate to leave my family, but I'll be watching from the other side. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. This is what it says. I'm going back to reading verse 9 again. We're going to make this all one part. The one who says he's in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. The one who loves his brother abides in the light, and there's no cause for stumbling in him. Do me a favor, underline stumbling. Stumbling. Highlight it, circle it, put an asterisk out to the side. There's no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. One of the saddest things that happens from time to time inside of churches all across the world doesn't happen at this one. We're kind of omitted from this. One of the saddest things that happens in churches from time to time is people will get their feelings hurt from another Christian within that church. I'm not going back to that church again. I can't believe what they said. I can't believe they said my noodles was the worst noodles they've ever had. They didn't know that I cooked those noodles. You better be careful about what you say when you're having a luncheon. Who made this? I made that. What are you talking about? I'll never come back to you again, I tell you. They put me down. Someone told me today, I don't know, someone back in the back, said, Pastor, how much weight have you lost? I said, I don't know. I don't know. They said, you need to get a different wardrobe. And I was like, I guess I do. I didn't realize that. And I told my daughter, I said, would you go home today? Get a jacket that fits, okay? So bring it back for me tonight. But that's the thing, you know. Ladies, when you ask your husband, does this dress make me look big? Don't put him in that situation, okay? Don't do that. Yeah. To say, hey, you got a point there, but if you comb your hair different, you'd cover it right up, okay? So here's the deal. Here's the deal. Listen to me. People can get hurt all the time in church. But here's one of the things I want you to understand, the next one on your outline. People living in and under the direction of the flesh will sometimes have their own agenda and want things their own way. You mean even in church? I do mean even in church. Because they're under the direction of the flesh. And so when they don't get things their own way, they get mad and they try to enlist. Did you see what they did? Did you hear what they did? Come on, let's get a mob mentality and go against them. I'm going to get them to dislike you even though they didn't do anything to you. They did the same thing to Jesus. Okay? So they tried to build that. So it doesn't sound like things have changed a lot from John's time to our very day. That's why it's so important. Listen to me, church. When I say church, I mean the body of Christ. That's so important to understand this. That when someone in the church hurts you, understand it wasn't the church that hurt you. Okay? It was an individual that was being used, listen to me, used by Satan to take you out. And a lot of times, Christians who are living more like the flesh and the world will bring Satan right into the building and they'll come and attack. So there's never, listen to me, there's never a reason why a Christian should say this, I'll never go back to another church if that's a Christian. I'll never go back to church because I don't want anything to do with that. And that's what we call a stumbling block. And that's what John said. And that's why I said underline that so that you do not become a stumbling block. So the next one on your outline, when a person gets hurt by someone in the church, it was not the church but a person that was used by Satan. Remember when we talked about in Ephesians, and we got a lot of these got the armor of God on us. It said, listen, remember, our battle's not against flesh and blood. It's against the princes and principalities of this world, of the darkness. And I can say even Satan himself is our enemy. That's who my battle's with. My battle's with him. It's not against you. You might make me upset. Hey, I'll forget it and I'll forgive you. But we're going to move past that because we have a greater plan. We're called to tell others about Jesus. And so what Satan will do is get Christians to be a stumbling block. He'll get you to be a stumbling block to another Christian. Or he might get you to be a stumbling block to someone who's getting ready to trust Christ. So you better be ready. So, Satan will use anything he can through you to be a stumbling block to get you to stop serving the Lord. Well, I'm not going to be an usher anymore. I'm telling you what, they gave me that ugly basket. Doesn't match the rest of them. It is not happening. They never let me do the front. I'm on camera when I'm up front. I'm telling you, see, that made me. That's all about me. Okay, so it's not about you. It's about him. And I want to tell you about Jesus. I want you to grow in the Lord. And so maybe he'll use that. And if he can get you to stop serving, you know what he's done? He's hurt more than just you. Everyone that you is going to minister to is now going to be taken back because you stepped back. I'm not going to do it anymore. Well, I'm going to tell you, when you serve the Lord, you're going to get a much better blessing than what you'll ever give anyone else. I used to, when I first became a deacon, I'd go on hospital visits. I'd go in there. I'd say, what am I going to say? I don't really know what to say. I'm afraid I'll say the wrong thing. And then, boy, get out of here, you know. And, you know, they taught us, don't ever say, yeah, I've been there. I know what, you'll be fine. Don't say that. Aunt Betsy might die from that, you know, from getting the appendix taken out. You just don't say things like that. You know, I've been there. You'll be fine. Don't say that. So I walked in there. I was scared to death. I said, what do I say to these people? And I go in and I see them and I talk to them and they, you know what? God took over. And I walked out of there smiling, just walking a little bit higher on the cotton, you know what I'm saying? And I felt just blessed. And I don't even know what I said, but they seemed to be blessed. And I was blessed. And I walked out of there blessed. It was a great day. So we can do that. Satan will use Christians as a stumbling block in so many ways to take out other Christians as well as the lost. So let me apply it to you like Jesus did. Let me ask you a question. And I want you to give an honest answer. I don't want hands up. I don't want you to say, oh, yeah, Pastor, because I can tell just by looking at you. Here's the question. If you answer honestly in your heart and in your mind, do you love all your brothers and sisters in Christ? Do you love them? So many churches think they're in competition with each other. You know what we say here at this church? If someone's happy at their church, leave them alone. Yeah. There's more people out there dying and going to hell. We got to tell them. That's the ones we are after. We're not going to build our church up by someone that doesn't know Jesus. Now, sometimes God will disrupt someone and say, hey, I need you over this church because they have that need right now, and you're going to feel that need. But listen, don't go out and knock on the neighbor's door or attend church regularly and say, come say, but if he's bringing you here, I want you here. Okay? So if you say, well, you know them people down at that church over there, don't want anything to do with them. Pastor, you don't know what they did to me. I'm telling you what, I don't even want to say the worst of all things, but, you know, here, think about the worst thing that's ever happened to you. Did you forgive them? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Did you tell them you loved them? It's hard. You can love the sinner and hate the sin. That someone who's been taking advantage of you, and I told you you can have a righteous anger, say, it's time to cut you off. I love you, but I'm not going to enable you. We have so many people who work in rehab and things like that here. Listen, I got to cut you off. I love you, but I'm telling you, I can't enable you. Do you see where I'm going?
Yeah.
So John says, if you're walking around in the dark, if you don't love your brothers the way you're supposed to, because if you don't love other Christians the way we're supposed to love other Christians, and I promise you this, if you do not love other Christians the way we're supposed to love them, there's no way you can love your fellow man the way you're supposed to. You can't do it. Because we make it all about us. The reason we've been putting all these long weeks in, the fair, the reason we handed out 4,000 little Jesuses, because we want people to know about Jesus. Everybody needs a little Jesus in their life, you know? Really, we need a whole lot of Jesus. But you couldn't carry those around, you know? Wouldn't that be funny? So, hey, the reason we spent all that time out there was to tell others about Jesus. The reason we put in these long days, angels standing up here this whole time. You remember that yesterday? They're starting back. Everybody else that I sat down, them angels over here. The arms didn't go up as far, did they, Renee? Yeah, they got tired at the end of the day. The reason we put in those long days is to tell people about Jesus. That's what it's all about. Tell them, the reason we had the Connect Sunday, remember everybody got the Lego? Connect to people. The reason we had the Land Cruise, remember the Land Cruise? I want you to come in and let me tell you about Jesus. Remember we were laying things down at the altar. I'm going to do another one. We're going to have the Western Roundup. Yeah, and I'm going to talk to anyone and everyone who does barbecue and smoked meats, and we're going to have us a barbecue. Someone's already into it, okay? Yeah. Yeah, that's good eating, I'll tell you that right now. So the reason we're putting all this in, heaven's gates, hell's flames, so we can tell people about Jesus. And so I pray that you do not become a stumbling block. So you know what that means? Be very careful with your words. Well, if Joe over there, he's a Christian, I've heard he curses like you would not believe. Well, it's because he's from the military. You better be part of God's army. Better be careful with your words. You better be careful with your actions. Hey, you, go to heaven. Give them the finger, right? You, go to heaven. Be careful with your actions. Hey, you better be very careful with what you eat and drink. You mean alcohol? I mean alcohol. You better be very careful. Okay, you could be used as a stumbling block. Be very careful how you treat that waitress. There's a hair in this. Can you believe that? There's a fly in that. What? Take that back. I want a free meal. You got to tell her. You got to just. Whoa, be careful. Okay. Hey, how about this one? You better be careful because what about that store clerk? I saw that back there. It said $2.99, not $3.49. I want my 50 cent. Now, get the manager. Give me that manager right here, right now. I'm taking something out of here free. How about this? You're at work. Well, I think we need to do it this way. I'm a construction guy. We need to do it this way. We need to run conduit this way. We're going to pull. No, I think you really ought to run it from this side. I've seen guys come to fist fight, haven't we, Chris? Okay, hey, you better be careful because you become a stumbling block. Now, I'm going to take this even a little bit further. When you're in church being all churchy, listen, Listen to me. You're following along, hopefully, with the outline. And you know when I'm getting close to the end, the worst time in the world to have that bathroom break is at the invitation. So here's what happens. It happens every Sunday. Churches across the world, they all do this. Okay, it's just not just here. So if I offend you, I'll be over here in the visitor's room. Come on up and apologize to me and I'll forgive you. Tell you I love you. Okay, but here's the deal. Here's what happens. Churches across the world, let's get ready for an invitation. We're going to invite you to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And you know what happens? Everybody gets up and goes to the restroom. You know what? I better pick up my coffee cup and throw it away right before he... Listen, don't do that. I'd rather you leave it on the floor than get up to go throw it away. I'd rather you get up in the middle of my sermon. I would. I would rather you leave while I'm praying for the invitation than for you with the invitation. And I say, would you all please stand and rise and let's join in this invitation song. Then for you to leave, because you know what people think? Someone's saying, you know what? I was ready to trust Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, but they're leaving. He must have said something that offended them. I'm going with them. And even though I might not leave, they've already left. And they had never stepped by that aisle and come forward. And Jesus says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And so do not become that stumbling block that might keep someone from coming to the Lord. That also includes talking. You know, I didn't know I had this. I think it's born in a lot of people. I have two things. If you're visiting, I have ADHD, I think. I've never finished the test because I didn't. Some of you got that. Okay. I got bored with it and moved on. But this, I have a tendency to do that. I'm married to a redhead. And she goes, give me that pen. I didn't know I was doing it. How about this one? We put those mints out there so that your breath doesn't run everybody away. Notice I've got one. Like I said, I'm just joking. Okay. But once we put that mint in our mouth, what do we do? My wife has reached over and grabbed that out of my hand. I said, what? She goes, would you stop playing with that paper? I become a 4-year-old real fast. That, my friend, is a stumbling block. So we're to that point of the service that every note from the first note played, bang, was to get to this point. Every note we sang was to get us to the throne of God, to prepare our hearts for His word. And I believe today He's speaking to you. We're going to give a hymn of invitation here in a minute, and I'm going to invite you to step out, first of all, to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Say, hey, I need to trust Jesus. I'm tired of walking around in the dark. I can't do it on my own anymore. Step out, come forward, meet me right down here, and I'll have someone take you to another room, show you what God's Word says. You make that decision. We'll not pressure you to do anything, but we're going to show you what God's Word says. If you're afraid to do that, grab the hand of the person beside you, even though you might not know them. Chad and Sabrina. Sabrina looked back when she got saved. She turned around and said, would you go up for me? Because Chad already went up by himself. He left his wife sitting in the seat. Come forward. He said, I got to get saved. And Chad come forward. And Chad used to be the priest for the Wiccan. Right? Am I right? High priest for the Wiccan. And he got saved and said, Jesus Christ. Great testimony. Okay. So he's getting saved, and his wife's like, well, I need someone to go up for him. And she's a little scared. She turned around. I don't even remember who he turned around to. He just turned around and says, would you go forward with me? And that person went forward with him. Didn't even know him. That first time there. So grab that person and say, would you go up with me? I trust me. They will all come up with you. Okay? Maybe you're looking for a church home. My goodness, God's been doing some amazing things here at Real Joy. We'd love to have you be a part of this church. And you say, God, if you want me here, I'm going to go join. I know you have blessings for me where you want me to serve. Just come forward and say, hey, I want to join this church. We'll have someone walk you out of the room, fill out some paperwork, ask some questions. I'm telling you what, we'll celebrate that God sent you with us. We're happy for that. Maybe you want to come to the altar and pray. Maybe you want to come to the altar and pray for tonight, Monday night, and Tuesday night for the souls of the individuals sitting in those seats. And as Dwayne said, there's going to be three people sitting in those seats, so you need to be praying for each night for those individuals to come to know. Let the Holy Spirit move in them so that when that gets to that invitation time, they'll jump up out of their seat and come to Jesus. Amen. That's what I'm praying for. Wouldn't it be nice to have a revival start in Chillicothe right at Real Joy? Wouldn't that be nice? But you know, it starts right now. Let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now. Thank you so much for your word and how it speaks to us. And God, as we have come to you looking at your word, God, we know that you're in control of all things. God, you know that we're here. You know where we are spiritually. We may be even fooling ourselves, but honestly, God, you know our hearts. So, God, if there's someone here that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, I'm praying that you give them the courage to step out to trust you today. Father God, if there's someone here that's looking for a church home, you know we've been praying for workers, for those people to get involved to serve you. Right here alongside of us in the trenches, God, give them that courage to step out and say, I want to be a part of this church. Whatever decision might be, come to the altar and pray. God, I'm asking your spirit to move in this room and that you and your son, Jesus Christ, will be glorified. Father, we love you and we thank you. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand up?
Thanks for worshiping with us today. Hopefully God has spoke to you in a mighty, mighty way. Maybe he has tugged at your heart today where you feel that you need to give your heart to Christ. That's what we call being saved or salvation. Maybe you need to rededicate your life to Christ. Maybe you've been going down a wrong path and you need to get back to Christ. Or maybe you want to know more about our church, or you have a prayer request that you'd like us to pray for you. So what I'm going to ask you to do, if any of those things touched your heart today, I'm going to ask you to go online to www.real-joy.org and get on our contact information page on our tab right there and put that information in there. I'd like to know how to be saved. I'd like to know more about rededicating my life. I'd like to have a prayer request or more information about the church. Or maybe you'd like to have a visit from one of our deacons. Put that on there and we'll get information back out to you as soon as possible or have that visit set up with you. But we really enjoyed you being here with us today, worshiping through our live stream. And so I hope you have enjoyed it. In fact, I hope you enjoyed it so much that you'll want to come and visit with us one day at 1954 Hospital Road, right by the fireworks store here in Chillicothe, right off 207. And you'll want to come and be a part of Real Joy. God's doing some amazing things here. We're growing like crazy. We've only been here for a little under a year, but we're hopefully going to be here a lot longer. You know what I mean? So we're glad that you're enjoying it, and hope to see you next week, or maybe I can see you in person. So thank you for being with us today. God bless you.